Good morning. How are you this morning? Good? Yeah, I'm so glad you are here in the house of the Lord on this beautiful Sunday morning. We've gathered together to celebrate the Lord is our good shepherd and we are his sheep. May the Lord bless us this morning and touch our hearts and mind and soul, spirit, so that we may be whole today. Now let us center our hearts in the presence of the Lord to worship him in the spirit and truth.
Will you please stand as you are able and join us together in hymn 2074, Shout to the Lord.
Thank you.
Let us join in the opening prayer. Together we say, by word and sign, O God, you identified Jesus at his baptism that we might know him to be your beloved one, the vessel of your goodness. By that same grace, you have united us in Christ and called us your people. How dimly we understand such love. Deepen our faith, intensify our zeal, unite the separated branches of your church that we may bear an undivided witness before the world through Jesus Christ, in whom you are pleased to dwell. Amen. You may be seated.
The King of our shepherd is
Invite the children forward for their special time in the service.
Thank you. And I'm kind of old, and when I went to Sunday school, we used to come home with homework. And one of our homework was to memorize Psalm 23. And my mom was a Sunday school teacher, so that was a lot of what you did while dinner was being prepared. You worked on memorizing Psalm 23. So it's kind of in the back of my brain, and sometimes it pops up at the weirdest times when I'm thinking of something. But one of my favorite parts is the part that the sermon is on today, which is the part about he restores my soul. So what I want to know is, do you know what restore my soul even means? Do you know if something that's been restored? Has anybody lived in a restored house or seen somebody restore a piece of furniture? What'd they do to it? Nothing. Did they fix it? Like maybe God helps fix us in a variety of different ways. And one of those ways is when we come to church on Sunday and in Sunday school. And in everything that you learn from Sunday school and do all through the week. He helps to keep you going. Now, food can be a way to restore. And last Sunday, what did we do after church? Yeah, what did we have downstairs? Do we have an event? We had food downstairs, right. And what came along with the food after the food? Was there some bike riding? And some games and playing because the toys are there. And that's kind of a way of restoring, isn't it? It made you feel good when you left here. And that's what we try to do, is think about how to make ourselves feel better and help others and reach out to us and the world around us. So when you go to Sunday school today, you can think of me who went home with homework. And we hardly ever had craft projects. Because that was so not 1960s. It was mostly like little books. So I have a prayer, and can you repeat it after me? Dear God, we thank you for watching over us and helping us to restore ourselves in so many different ways. We know you are with us every day and everywhere. Thank you for all you do for us. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay, now I bet there's probably some fun project downstairs that has no homework involved. Have fun. Who's going?
As the children head off, let us stand and share the peace of Christ. Please be seated. Our scripture this morning continues to draw on Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his namesake. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Joel. During Lent this year, we are preaching through the Psalm 23rd, about one verse per Sunday. And today's verse is verse 3. It says, He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. So there are two parts in that verse. And this morning, I am going to focus on the first part, He restores my soul, to finish our service on time. I suspect you like that idea. Right? Yeah. He restores my soul. Friends, the Good Shepherd, our Lord Jesus Christ, restores your souls and mine. And there is a story in all three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, how the Good Shepherd, Christ Jesus, restored a nameless woman's soul 2,000 years ago. And it's a very good one. So listen to this. One day, Jesus was with a large crowd as usual, and respected synagogue ruler whose name was Jairus came to him, and he fell at Jesus' feet and pleaded fervently with him to come to his house to heal his darling daughter, his only child. He was desperate. And now Mark chapter 5, verses 24 through 34. Listen to what happened next. So Jesus went with him. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had, yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Immediately, her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body, and she was freed from her suffering. At once, Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" "You see the people crowding against you," his disciples answered, "and yet you can ask who touched me?" But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet and, trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." Friends, we don't know her name. But we do know three things about her. Number one, She had been suffering from an incurable bleeding for 12 years. Number two, she was a woman in a society where men prayed in public, "Thank God I am not a woman." Number three, she was untouchable. In those days, illness was considered a punishment to their sins from God. In the Greek Bible, the word illness from this story basically means scourge or whip. So people labeled her sinful. Most likely, people thought she must have done something terrible. She had a hidden secret. Obviously, the bleeding is the result of her sins. She received what she deserves. And beware, her sinfulness, her illness is contagious. Therefore, anyone she touches will become sinful and unclean as well. She is untouchable. That was who she was. And she had been unclean, sinful, and untouchable for 12 years. You know, 12 years is a long time. In old Korean saying, in 10 years, even mountains change, which means 10 years is a long time. And she had been suffering in this condition, with this condition for 12 years. The society had denied her all access to touch or to be touched by her family, friends, and everyone. And there had been no personal relationship with anyone for 12 years. Can you imagine? And one day, she heard about Jesus, what he had done for the blind, the deaf, and those who are helpless and hopeless, and those who are forgotten and invisible by the majority. And she thought, if what I've heard is true, then if I just touch his clothes, then I will be made well. However, it is a small town. And we all know that what a small town is like. Everybody knows everybody, sometimes too much. Her secret wouldn't have been unknown. No one wants her near, so I imagine. Her face would have been veiled, and off she went. And in the veil, she would have kept repeating to herself, "If I just touch his clothes, if I just touch his clothes, if I just touch his clothes." And now, Jesus, his disciples, and a large crowd are heading off toward the house of Jairus. The crowd is trying to rush with Jesus, but a large crowd cannot move very fast. What a perfect condition for her to touch
Jesus' clothes. So she sneaks into the crowd and tries to find a crack here and opening there, and finally makes it near to Jesus. Her heart is pounding faster and faster with fear. She pushes, she shoves, and behold, she touches the end of Jesus' clothes. Immediately, the Bible says, immediately the bleeding stopped. The pain disappeared. Health and vigor were surging through every part of her body. She was cured. And she stopped to feel her healthy body, I imagine. And she breathed deeply. Her eyes glowed with joy, relief, and excitement. But at that moment, Jesus stopped. And he turned around in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" Why did he say that? Because Jesus realized the power had gone out from him. So her joyful moment didn't last long. Now she must have desire to find a way to escape. She froze. She wanted to melt away. She wanted to be invisible. While she was struggling with what to do next, whether she was going to keep silent or come forward to Jesus, his disciples gave her a perfect chance to remain where she was. They said, "You see the people crowding against you, and yet you can't ask who touched me?" In other words, they said, "Master, who touched me? You've got to be kidding me. Lord, look around you. Can't you see a crowd is jostling you? Everyone who surrounds you touches you, of course. And we've got to hurry to the house of Jairus, the respected synagogue ruler, leader. We should not waste our time here." That is what they said. But Jesus was not talking about that kind of touch, you know. He was looking for someone who touched his clothes not accidentally, but purposely. He was looking for someone who touched his clothes not with finger, but with faith. So he was searching. He was searching for that person in the surrounding crowd. For him, it was not wasting time at all. Jesus was looking around the crowd one by one with a piercing gaze. And now picture this. With fear and trembling, she stepped out of the crowd and came forward with the veil falling from her face. Neighbors in the crowd gasped when they saw who was coming to confess. It was the unclean, sinful, and untouchable woman. Halting me, she began to explain. She began to tell her story. Bleeding for 12 years, doctors, money, getting worse, desperation, and her last hope of, if I just touch. Her story was a story of despair, a story of shame, anger, guilt, brokenness, and loneliness. In front of Jesus and the surrounding crowd, she told it to him. Jesus heard it, and the crowd heard it also. It was so quiet. It was so quiet you could hear a pin drop. And then, what did Jesus say to her? Do you remember? Anyone?
Yes.
What did he say?
Before
that, daughter, did you know that this is the only time in four Gospels Jesus called anybody daughter? Oh, this is really good. What does that mean to her? It means, by calling her daughter, Jesus gave her something she had been without for long 12 years. That was relationship. She was nobody. Not anymore. There was relationship. She had been nobody, but now she's somebody. A child of God. Jesus said, daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering. Friends, the Bible says Jesus realized. He realized that power had gone out from him, which means he already knew that somebody was made well physically. Someone was cured by his power. And Jesus had something else in his mind, though. Why do you think Jesus searched for this woman in that situation? They are in a hurry to go to Jairus' house. Jesus looked for this woman because he wanted to heal her soul. He wanted to restore her soul, which is only possible to know who she is in Christ. Brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, may I tell you that God does not always cure you, but he always heals you. Did you get the difference? Physical cures are only for a time. That's why I said God does not always heal you. Cure you. But he always heals you. Physical cures are only for a time, but the healing of heart is forever. And here is a poem about this story by an anonymous, and I quote, "Who touched me? It was the voice of the master. And the woman's heart beat faster and faster. Trembling, she came and bowed her head. I touched thee, Lord, was what she said. But the master answered, go thy way. Thy faith has made thee whole this day. Have you touched me? I heard it. It was voice of the master, and oh, my heart beat faster and faster. You came with the throne of God's house today, but I felt not your touch as you went your way." Unquote. So let me ask you a question. Have you touched the Lord this morning? If not, you can do that today. In fact, you are invited to touch your good shepherd as you sing the hymn that we will sing together after this message. The song is, "He Touched Me." And He will restore your soul. And Jesus wants you to know and claim, you are somebody. You are somebody in Christ, a precious child of Almighty God. So may you touch Jesus this morning with your faith. With your faith, as you confess, as you tell your brokenness, burdens, and whatever that steals your joy and peace from you. Friends, here's the good news. Your Lord, your good shepherd, will not only listen to your story, but He will heal you. He will make you whole. He will restore your soul. And He will say, "My daughter, my son, your faith has made you well. Go in peace." Now let us bow our heads to pray. Oh, our gracious and loving God, you've touched us by your grace. And you are waiting for us to complete the circle of the relationship by our touching you through faith. Holy Spirit, pray for us and with us with deep sighs that word cannot express this morning, so that today will be the day to touch you through our faith, that we may have the peace and joy that pass all human understanding today and the days to come. And we pray this in the name above all names, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now, would you please stand and join me singing our hymn of response, "He Touched Me." may be seated. With a heavy heart, I say that Janice, when she went to be the Lord this morning, 5:50, Bill and their son David were with her. And Bill expressed his gratitude for everyone's prayers and kindness. Her service is pending at this point, and it will be announced. So please continue to pray for Bill and Dave and their family, for God's peace that passes all human understanding as they are walking through the valley of the shadow of death. And also our nursery coordinator, Skylar, her grandfather unexpectedly passed away yesterday. So please also keep her family in your prayers and thought. And our world experienced such a darkness last week by the evil act in New Zealand. And our grieving continues. So prayers for those who lost their loved ones. Prayers for survivors and their families. This is very, very difficult time. And I pray for all of us so that we may guard our hearts from despair, discouragement, and disappointment, and cynical thought. We have to guard our hearts because life comes from our heart. And this is time to share our joys and concerns together as faith community. So, anyone?
I have a couple of concerns and a joy. For one of Jordan's classmates' mom on March 5th at the age of 38 unexpectedly passed away. So pray for the Hertz family for their strength and healing during their time of loss. And two, my cousin who's 48 unexpectedly had a PE and subsequently had an MI 3 days ago. Fortunately, he was in the hospital when it happened. He was without oxygen for 10 minutes. His whole resuscitation was for an hour. And he actually woke up 2 days ago, was alert, and yesterday he was extubated, meaning the tube was removed. He's talking, but he has a very, 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 very long road ahead of him. So praying for his healing, recovery, and praying for our family, for our strength with him, for him. And two, I graduated from my fellowship program in integrative medicine on February 14, 2019. So I am now a specialist. Thank you.
Thank you for the good news. We need that. So we are rejoicing in the wonderful news. Thank you.
Yes. I have a joy. I attended Lenten service with just saying I've never been to this type of Lenten service because I'm Baptist and we don't celebrate Lenten in that way. I am now Methodist, by the way.
Our gain. Their loss.
But I just want to let you know that the Lenten service is so powerful. I could not believe how it touched my soul.
You meant Lenten study, Lenten growth group?
Yes. Yes. Lenten okay. Group study. Mm-hmm. That's at the home. This time it's going to be at Glenn's house, And I certainly hope if you have any hesitation, just knock it off your shoulder and come on, because it's really, really good. This is from a Baptist to a Methodist.
That's a great compliment. Hey, yay. See? So come join us. It's not intimidating Bible study at all. Come as you are, but you will be touched by the presence of the Holy Spirit. Anyone else? Yes. Welcome back.
I wanted to thank so many people here that I'm going to use the microphone instead of trying to get around to everyone that was so kind when I decided to test gravity and get acquainted with all of the medical staff again. But thank you so much for your concern and your prayers.
Anyone? Then let us bow our heads to pray as the Holy Spirit prays with us with deep sigh that word cannot express. Well, Heavenly Father, this morning we lift up all our brothers and sisters who are walking through the valley of the shadow of death. Lord, put your arms around them and give your strength and peace that passes all human understanding. And help them to see the true hope that our Lord Jesus Christ has given us. And gracious and loving God, hold tight those who have lost their loved ones last week with your righteous right hand and sustaining grace. Holy Spirit, we are tired of darkness and hungry for light. We are tired of hatred and hungry for acceptance, and we are tired of apathy and hungry for compassion. Heavenly Father, when we have no strength, we have you who do not faint or grow weary. When we have no answers, we have you whose understanding is unsearchable. So Holy Spirit, touch our hearts and minds and transform them this morning so that we may become the people we have been called to be in this community and beyond. And we pray this in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who also taught us this prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This is
There are many opportunities this week and in the future to live our faith. Highlight just a few. Meal site is coming up March 28th. So you can sign up in the back. Volunteers will leave carpool and go down to St. Paul at 4:20. Today in this sanctuary, we will have a presentation about the special general conference, the results of which many of you are aware of. We will remain here in the sanctuary for that presentation, and then immediately after, welcome to go back to the parlor and have your coffee and other fellowship. The Spire is looking for a new editor. Those of you who made at least a passing grade in English composition in high school and would like to have some atonement for not doing better, here's an opportunity for you to help out. So please see Ginger if you're interested in that opportunity. And there is a Lenten growth group study that you can sign up for in the Narthex. And just as a way to introduce that, I invite you to watch this short clip.
It's been said that the Holy Land is the fifth gospel. Walking its city streets, seeing its unique geological formations, its topography and its terrain, and visiting its traditional holy sites changes how you read the gospels. My name is Adam Hamilton, and I'm the author of 24 Hours That Changed the World, a study of the last day of Jesus' life. And I'd like to invite you on a journey in which I'm going to be retracing the steps of Jesus from the Mount of Olives to Mount Calvary. We're going to visit the traditional holy sites that you would visit if you were walking in the streets of Jerusalem today. And each step along the way, with the book and with the video resource, we're going to be asking the questions, what is the meaning of Jesus' suffering, death, and resurrection? How do I find myself in the story? And what is it that I might see and understand differently by being in this place? I hope you'll invite friends to join us and plan to be a part of this journey, 24 Hours That Changed the World.
Thank you.
Things come from you. So this morning, with a grateful heart, we have brought our offering to you. Oh Lord, our offering is our heart and our dedication and our commitment to make disciples of Jesus Christ through Mequon United Methodist Church. So Lord, accept it and bless it so that it may be used to make your love real in this community and beyond. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Now would you please join me our closing hymn 2173, Shine, Jesus, Shine. Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. the Lord lift up his countenance unto you and give you peace. Important appointment that you may leave, but if you have 15 minutes or 20 for the presentation, I very, very appreciate your time. Can you hear me?
Yes, is this something that's going to be on the screen?
Over here, yes.
Okay, that's fine.
Not right now, but yes, it will. Before the presentation, can you hear me? Before the presentation, I think we have kind of a very brief United Methodist 101 class. So to know our structure. So everyone has this paper? If you don't have, please raise your hand so that you may receive it. Would you please give first screen? While we are waiting, do you know how many members of Methodist? I'm not saying United Methodist, there are many Methodists. I grew up Korean Methodist. So Korean Methodist Church is different from United Methodist, but still Methodist, meaning we follow John Wesley's legacy. Do you know how many Methodists in the world? Just guess, trivia. Just guess. Huh? 50 million? 20 million? Oh, you have a little faith. It's more than 50. According to my research yesterday, Google, it says 80 million. Okay, so 80 million in the world, Methodist. Every Methodist in it, Nazarene and Methodist Zion and Episcopal, everything. And among 80 million Methodists, United Methodist is the biggest denomination in Methodist circle. We have over 12 million lay members. Okay? And our structure is the paper, just like a government. Executive, legislative, and judicial. And general conference, I put some kind of information down there. General conference is only the entity with the authority to speak on behalf of entire United Methodist Church. And they meet every 4 years. But so they met 2016, so their regular meeting is 2020. But they met this year, which is 2019, because of special thing they have to do. And the issue is the human sexuality. But before jump that issue, I think we have to understand our cultural context. So again, United Methodist Church is not just United Methodist Church, churches in the United States. It's a global church. So we have United Methodist in Africa, Asia, and Europe. So if you go to the other side, I did some research yesterday. Number two, United Methodists around the world. So according to our denomination website, 13 years ago, 2006. Lay members in the United States is almost 8 million. I'm not good at numbers. So 7 million and almost 8 million. At that time, Central Conferences means in Africa, Europe, and Asia. Their membership is 3.5 million. 10 years later, which is 2016, did you see that number? In the United States, United Methodist Churches in the United States, we lost almost 1 million. Did you see that? Are you seeing that? But Central Conference, they gained members, 84%. So delegate for General Conference, the number of delegates is decided based on members, which means they have more delegate for General Conference. So if you see that this column, legislative, let's start bottom, charge conference, local church. Once a year we have charge conference, right? Mequon United Methodist Church. So above church conference, district conference. We are in, do you know, anyone knows which district we are? Southeast Conference, okay? Southeast District. And then above district, annual conference. That we are Wisconsin Annual Conference. In the United States, we have 54 annual conference. Outside of United States, which is Central Conference, they have 75 annual conference now. And above jurisdictional, 5 jurisdictional conference and central conferences. I just put that because it's easy to see that way. It's easier to understand. And we are, Wisconsin Conference belongs to North Central Jurisdiction Conference. Did you see the map? Okay, so. And then above jurisdictional conference, what is it? General Conference. And that is the body to decide on behalf of entire church. And the issue, the human sexuality is not simple. It's very complicated just because we are a global church. Different cultural context. And one of United Methodist pastors who serves in Virginia, I think, his name is Tom Bellin, he explained it so well, eloquently, so I'd like to share that clip, which is less than 3 minutes. Before we jump in the issue, okay? So now let's take a look, yes.
Global, we're global. And what that means is we include a lot of folks on the continent of Africa. That's our fastest growing part of the church. Multiple languages, you know. You've got in any country in Africa, you typically have 1 to 2 tribal languages that are indigenous, but then you also have like Cote d'Ivoire on the Ivory Coast, or Lodi and I Methodist there, there's French speaking. You know, and you've got, then you go on over to the Philippines, so you're in part of Asia there. We've got a big presence in the Philippines. And then you come to the United States, and of course, we're all over the U.S., we're in every state. We're, more of us are on the East Coast in the center of the country than on the West Coast by a pretty good number. Part of that's because we stopped building new churches in the 1940s, and so the West Coast didn't get as many churches established. And it's unfortunate that we did that. That's when we lost a lot of our original zeal that some of us would like to see return. So you've got multiple cultures, and remember in Africa, in about half the countries in Africa right now, if you are caught in a homosexual act, that is criminalized. So when you come to the table internationally and you talk about LGBTQ inclusion, the African delegates will tell you that one of the issues they struggle with in their country is there are people in their churches who say, well, we don't have that here, that doesn't exist. So the conversation doesn't start with inclusion, it starts with acknowledgement. And I'll just tell you, somebody that grew up in Virginia, I find that just sort of stunning, right? But we also don't want to be colonial about how we do church. So lots of folks in Africa have experienced colonialization where white people came in, said, this is what you'll do and this is what you'll believe. And so our church has really worked very hard to acknowledge the cultural context, but also to guard that, to try to have an international inclusive denomination. But at the same time, in the United States, there are certain issues that just culturally have a different context than they do in other parts of the globe. And most of us are, most of the people I hang out with are in the United States. And so how do you do an international church? Like it's virtually with 8 million, 11 million people. That's really, so are you starting to get the complexity of what I'm talking about? It's in that environment that we're talking about these.
Okay, so that is the cultural context.
Global. We're global.
You're done now. So the issue is human sexuality. I think it's early 70s. This line in the Book of Discipline. Book of Discipline is a guiding book for United Methodist Church. The these lines that I shared here, the paper included. That is, practice of homosexuality is incompatible with Christian teaching. Therefore, self-avowed practicing homosexuals are not to be certified as candidates, ordained as ministers, or appointed to serve in the United Methodist Church. Another one is, ceremony that celebrate homosexual unions shall not be conducted by our ministers and shall not be conducted in our churches. So there are two issues about the general conference, special general conference, and that was the issue. The group people, and in majority, I have to say, majority in the United States, they really think we have to be truly open church, so they want to remove this language. The other group of people, more conservative or traditional understanding of the Bible, they want to keep it. So that is the battle and every general conference. And the last general conference, 2016, they think we cannot continue this way. So we have to decide something before regular general conference, which is next year. And that's why they met and this year. Their decision, as you know, is traditional. We're going to keep traditional understanding for United Methodist Church. And there's a video clip that was provided by our denomination. It's kind of 5 minutes to summarize, kind of summary of the special general conference. So now let's take a look.
The 2019 special session of the General Conference of the United Methodist Church is now in session.
This conference is definitely a time in history. I know a lot of people who wanted to be here because it was a historical moment, because it was the 1968, it was the 1844.
My hope is that we can truly leave here with the best way forward.
No matter what the outcome, we show the world, we as United Methodists know how to disagree in love.
We started praying, and I felt God is here. My prayer for this time is that the peace of God will fall upon everyone who enters this building.
Es necesario levantar la mano y decir yo estoy presente porque somos el cambio.
I guess the hardest thing for me is the sense of anxiety and the fears about what might come out of this general conference.
For us in Norway, we're so small that this might be an existential crisis. We might not survive a split.
Even though we do not all think alike, this is the idea. We have more in common than we disagree about.
The One Church plan includes protection so that no one has to act in a contrary way to their convictions.
The traditional plan values unity in doctrine. For United Methodists, the clarion call of the inspired Word of God burns in our hearts.
I'm grateful to be part of this body where we can come and discern God's will and see the way forward for the church.
Let me tell you why I want you to vote for the One Church plan. The model of church that we have is based on the health of every region.
It is a false narrative that this One Church plan fixes our problems or allows each of us to minister as we see fit.
Voting on this amendment
is
to burn down the church in Africa.
It received a vote and it will appear on the screen. So you have not passed on the One Church plan, and we move to our next item on our agenda.
I think we also need to acknowledge that there's a lot of pain and disappointment in this room and also around the world for those who have been watching.
We support the traditional plan because it has helped the church in Africa. Today, the church in Africa is growing in leaps and bounds because we are committed to biblical Christianity.
But with the traditional plan that adds teeth, you've not only alienated progressives, but also centrists.
We have brought people to Jesus because they said they have not heard this message before. They didn't know God could love them because their churches said God didn't.
I am a young evangelical delegate. We pray for a world that is just, loving, caring, and whole, and also holy and sanctified.
I am going to move us to a vote on the traditional plan. Voting is now closed. Passes.
There has been a view that certain plans would be a vote for division and a view for other plans would be a vote for unity. But the clear thing to me has been that all of these plans are divisive.
I believe that developing a gracious exit is very important to our witness as Christians.
I can't stay in a church where everyone is not a welcome. So I would support this as a gracious exit that is just.
Leaving and disaffiliation is not of God, it's not of love.
If you vote to accept the minority report, press one. We've adopted the minority report.
I'm an immigrant. Before coming to the United States, I was a staunch evangelical. And then over the years, I was exposed to a different world and a different opinions, especially on the homosexuality. So I can understand both worlds, conservative or evangelical folks, and then what they're saying is not foreign to me.
I feel moved to start mending bridges and work to become one church again.
I need to open my mind and love more people and love more situations and learn to find out more what God is teaching me.
Without love, all of this work that we do, then it's nothing.
Thank you for your graciousness, for your forgiveness, and for the work that we will do as we go forth from this place.
Our work is really now to help the church to refocus on its mission. And we try to see the church for what it is, which is the diverse body of Christ.
Special conference decisions, two decisions. One is they adopted a traditional position, I mean stay where we are at this point. And the second one is exit plan. So if you don't want to stay, you can exit from United Methodist Church. But two of them right now have been challenged on constitutional in terms of process and everything. So judicial council are reviewing those. So we don't know until what is the details, how about this, all kind of thing, application part. We don't know until end of April. That is at this point where we are. And the Wisconsin annual conference next week, Bishop Cabinet and the clergy, we are going to have a meeting at the Green Lake for 4 days. Not only for this, but other things, but it's going to be, this will be discussed, and again, a local church, how can we keep our unity, just like Christ prayed for us on the night before his crucifixion. So many things are in the air. That is, I can say at this point, but we have to wait until what judicial council will say after they're reviewing the two decisions. So this morning we covered three things, as I said. First one, we are global church. United Methodist Church is global church and cultural context. And then second one, what is the issue for special general conference and what was their decision? And after my gathering with other clergy colleagues and cabinet and our church leaders, we will offer a discussion session, more application as a reconciling church. So this time it's just sharing facts. You have any question or discussion about whatever, stay tuned. We will have a time to do that. Any questions about those three things that I just shared? Yes, Jim.
What was the minority report?
Minority report over there?
Yeah.
That is exit. Exit strategy. That means those who don't agree with the decision, they have opportunity to leave United Methodist Church. Yes, exactly. But thing is, there is some kind of, you know, conditions about property, because as you know, all the properties belongs to United Methodist Church. The spoons and forks in our kitchen, they belongs to United Methodist Church. And so they had make some kind of exception, and so that was passed. So two decisions. But again, both of them have been challenged on constitutional in terms of process and many things. Yes? We will, I heard that we will be known by end of April.
There's an irony that we are in the midst of this kind of divisive discussion about tearing our church apart, giving the opportunity for churches to pull away right in the middle of Lent and celebration.
Mm-hmm.
There's an irony in that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not a good one.
Mm-hmm.
Yes? Specifically, this conference was held to discuss 304.3. The practice of homosexuality is incompatible with Christian teaching. Can somebody tell me what teaching of Jesus Christ said homosexuality is incompatible with his teaching? Who can point to the Bible, the Word of Christ, and say that he condemned homosexuality? I'd like to see that. Who can do that? That's what this is about.
Yeah.
The precept of this church is a faith in God and his Son, Jesus Christ, sent to save us from our sins. Jesus preached on the Sermon on the Mount. And I would like somebody to point out in Matthew 7, 6 and 7,
I think the issue, personally, I think the issue is not human sexuality. The issue is your interpretation of the Bible, how to interpret. So that part, again, this time it's just sharing facts. And after my gathering with the United Methodist clergy and our church leaders, we offer more discussion and more application part. And so what? You know, so what we are going to do as a body of Christ, as reconciling church in this community. So we will share our ideas, but I want to in line with guidance from our conference too. So, but thank you for your sharing. I know it's hard. Anyone else?
My question is, a lot of the churches who are reconciling congregations as we are, have in this time of powerful emotions expressed their support of our LGBTQ brothers and sisters by putting up a banner, by changing their websites, by making a public announcement of our support for our brothers and sisters in Christ. And I'm just wondering if we can do, I know we have to wait for the final decision in April to make our decision as a church, but in the meantime, can't we affirm who we are as a reconciling congregation by some overt message to the people who are hurting? That's my request, that we overtly say it, either on a website or in a banner out front, saying all are still welcome here. We are a reconciling church and we recognize love for all. So I just put that out there as, could we please do that? Thank you.
Thank you, Pat. Anyone else? All right, I think everyone wants to have a coffee, snack, fellowship time, and so we will continue the discussion, so stay tuned, and thank you so much.